Happy Lord's Day, brothers and sisters in Christ. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and of our Lord Jesus Christ. How are you all doing? Your pastors are constantly praying for you that God will give you strength and wisdom as you face new adjustments in your companies, in your workplaces, in schools, and of course, in our own homes. I pray that God's word today will continue to mold you and continue to help you live a life of service and love to Him. Before we proceed to our sermon this morning, allow me to read our passage based on Mark chapter 4, verses 35 until the end of the chapter. If you have your Bibles with you, turn with me to Mark chapter 4. We'll be reading from verse 35 until the end. Verse 35. On that day, when evening had come, He said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd, they took Him with them in the boat, just as He was, and other boats were with Him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But He was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke Him and said to Him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And He awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey Him?" Shall we bow our heads in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for another Sunday that we can gather together to worship You and hear from Your voice again. Thank You, Lord, for Your grace and sustenance in our lives, feeding us with our needs and allowing us to be healthy. We remember those who are sick. Lord, may You remember them in our prayers, and may You continue to be with them, comfort them, allow Your grace to be revealed in them. So Lord, as we hear Your word this morning, may You clear our minds from any distractions. May You open our hearts to receive Your word and apply it as necessary. This we ask and pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. How do you feel if someone called you slow? Slow, not like a slow runner, but slow when you are slow to pick up a joke. Now, I'm not going to tell you a joke today. We have people who do it better than me. But do you know what I discovered about jokes? For one to understand the joker, intellect and experience actually play a huge role. Without it, it will take time and explanation before a person gets it. You know, if jokes are explained again and again, it defeats its purpose. If explained and people still do not get it, who will end up frustrated? The joker, right? In this very famous passage of Mark, this is the same case with Jesus Christ, though he is not sharing a joke. Prior to our sermon passage this morning, if you look at the start of chapter 4, Jesus has already preached and taught the crowd and his disciples about four different kinds of parables. But no one seems to get his point. In Mark chapter 4 verse 10, the Bible says that when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked about the parables. It seems like no one ever gets what Jesus says. And as a joker who gets frustrated, he was also frustrated. Take a look at verse 13. The Bible says, "And he said to them, 'Do you not understand the parables? How then will you understand all the parables?'" Jesus phrases his questions containing a slight rebuke to his audience. "I have tried everything. What are other ways for you to get what I'm trying to say?" Then if you go back to the start of Mark, from chapter 1 to 3, Jesus healed a lot of people and he also taught them. Chapter 4, 1 to 9, Jesus tells a parable and even explains it from verses 10 to 20. Yet people still do not get who he is and what he's trying to say. Mark weaves his narrative to show Jesus is the Son of God. That is his main point. But in the early stages of his narrative, it seems like no one seems to get it. Therefore, Christ resorts to another alternative that we will focus on today, the calming of the storm. We will observe three things that shows Jesus as the Lord of all. Firstly, the odd weather. Secondly, the odd behavior of Christ. And lastly, the odd response of his disciples. Let's go back to verse 1 again, and we can see that Christ began teaching at the Sea of Galilee. After teaching for a while to the crowds by the sea, he decides to move over to the other side, perhaps to take a rest for a while from preaching the whole day, and also to minister to the people on the other side. So firstly, let's take a look at the odd weather. As they cross the sea, Mark adds a strong tension in verse 37. "A great windstorm arose, and the waves were filling the boat." They were breaking the boat. As a reader of the word, do you find this odd? You know, Mark seems to portray that when they cross, pertaining to Jesus and his disciples, and as the boat began to cross, a storm starts to build up. And later, we'll see that even the experienced fishermen cannot deliver themselves from these storm and the waves. The Sea of Galilee is actually a big lake. Having great winds and violent waves can occur, especially between May and October. Ponds and lakes are actually the calmest bodies of water because they are enclosed, as you can see in the photo behind me. And I remember one of my childhood memories, my hobbies actually, that I miss currently is going fishing. When we were still in the States, me and my father would often go fishing every Saturday morning at 6 a.m. so that we will have fish for lunch later on. And I remember that the lake was actually calm. The lake was very quiet, that all you hear is the buzzing of insects and sometimes the splashing of the fish. Otherwise, you don't hear any kind of noise. And my father would remind me also to remain quiet and still, or else the fish will not come near the bait. And even on Saturday mornings that have rains, even though there are rains, the waters are still calm. They don't look dangerous. So going back to the narrative, Jesus and his disciples were in a boat going to the other side of the lake. And we can note that this incident is actually an exception, that God's hand is visibly seen in manipulating the windy storm. And this is similar to an Old Testament prophet by the name of Jonah. He was running away from the Lord out of disobedience, and God created a storm in the path of the ship. And both stories showed that experienced sailors were unable to control the ship or the boat. Both stories show us that people fail and that the Lord really has control over creation. Now, in this part of Mark's narrative, it was still in the early part of Jesus' ministry. So Jesus desires his disciples to know him more. And that's the first thing that we can observe in this narrative, that the weather is odd due to its timing and violence. The storm reveals Jesus is the Lord and has authority over creation. Jesus knows this storm will rise. This incident is for us to see that people miss out on who Jesus is, even those close to him, his disciples. Even though they were able to see him cure the sick in the earlier chapters and see the wisdom that Jesus has, but they still failed to know who they were following. Though prophets in the past were able to perform miracles, but we know that there is more to the signs that Jesus showed. Secondly, we can observe that there the odd response of Jesus that's found in verse 38, the odd behavior of Christ. He was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And according to scholars, the stern is the backmost part of the ship or of the boat. And Mark includes this small detail here. Now, when we study narratives, remember that the author has the power to add or to omit details. And to add a small detail like the stern of a boat, what is Mark implying? What is Mark's reason? If you go to the science of motion, the back and front of a vehicle is where the strongest movement lie. Try sitting at the front or back of a van, and when the van goes over a hump at full speed, you will see that the one seated there will bounce from their chair. And I remember way back, my friends enjoy adventures and they enjoy thrills. And one of the places that we've been to was the theme park called Enchanted Kingdom. And if you've been there, you know one of its famous rides, the Anchors Away, which is actually a huge Viking ship that rocks back and forth. And as it builds momentum, it rocks faster and faster. The shaking becomes stronger and stronger. And since my friends are adventurous, they want to sit at the backmost part of the ship to experience the strongest adrenaline rush. Now, Jesus was asleep on the stern. And in the Greek language, that while the waves were filling the boat, as the wind continues to blow hard, or in the NIV, swamp, or meaning flooding the boat, and the boat must be rocking violently, that a person sleeping must already be awake as a result of that. And we see that the wind was blowing sea waters into the boat, for the Bible states that it was filling the boat. So how can Jesus remain asleep as his surroundings are filled with tensions? I remember my roommate in the seminary, if I go into the room very late at night and I just turn the knob as softly as I can, a small creak would already wake him up. What more the tensions that filled Jesus around him, yet he was still asleep on the cushion. Now going back to Jonah again, we remember that he was also asleep as the storm roared. But odd thing about Jonah is that he was a disobedient person, but peacefully asleep. We can observe two things about the behavior of Jesus here. we know that when Christ came into the world, he was both man and divine. He was full God and full man at the same time. So firstly, as a man, why he was asleep is because he has peace inside of him, knowing that the Heavenly Father is watching over him. We can also observe that as a human being, he taught the whole day and he got tired out of fatigue. So he was also resting. We see the humanity of Christ in that aspect. Secondly, as divine, he places his trust and confidence in God, knowing that he has a purpose, and that purpose is to die on the cross in our behalf. So God will not let him die in a storm or sink in a boat. But being divine at the same time, we can also observe that he foreknew this incident would happen. And perhaps he wanted to test the faith of his disciples. How well does his disciples know him? So far, we can observe two things about this narrative. Earlier, the odd weather that it suddenly came up as they were crossing the sea. And secondly, the odd behavior of Christ. He was peaceful and asleep, even though there was tensions all around him. John Chrysostom writes this, and I quote him, "Jesus' sleeping showed that he was a man. His calming of the seas declared him God." John Chrysostom says that Jesus' sleeping showed he was a man. His calming of the seas declared him God. Let's not forget this. For instance, before we go to our third point, let's have this scenario. If you were one of the disciples of Jesus and the waves were filling the boat was getting heavy, it's starting to sink, how would you react? Would you panic like the disciples in the story? Would you wake Jesus up and scold him for sleeping and not helping as everybody else is rowing the boat? Or would you remain calm knowing that the Son of God is with you? What would you choose, or how would you react if you were one of those people in the boat? The last point we shall take a look at is the odd response of his disciples to the situation. And that's found in verse 38. They woke Jesus up and asked, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" Some of the disciples are actually experienced fishermen. And by resorting to Jesus, it seems like their skills are not able to save them anymore. They have given up all hope, for the storm was too severe for them. The way Mark tells the dialogue of the disciples seems to contain a slight rebuke. And as they panicked because they were at the brink of sinking, Jesus was fast asleep and does not seem to care about the situation and what is happening around them. So the way they approach Jesus is similar to the way the captain approached Jonah. When Jonah was called by God and he chose to go to the other side of Nineveh, God sent a storm in the path of the ship. And if you remember correctly, Jonah was asleep in the innermost part of the ship. And the captain went down to him and told him, "Don't you care that we are perishing, yet you are still asleep? Call to your God that he may rescue us." So we see here that the captain rebuked Jonah in the same way the disciples rebuked Christ for sleeping. The disciples showed a similar character like the captain when they approached Jesus. They were not happy to see an unhelpful person while everyone else was doing their best. Though Jesus was asleep like Jonah, didn't mean that he was showing a similar attitude with Jonah. Of course not. Definitely not. Though Jesus was asleep, he knew what was going on, and this could be a test for his disciples. So as Jesus awoke, he stood up firm with authority and rebuked the wind and the sea in verse 39. And what happened? There was a great calm. After the sound of waves crashing into the boat, after the sound of the howling wind, there was a deep silence. It could have been a deafening silence after Jesus rebuked the wind and the sea. Then turning to his disciples, the Lord rebukes them back for their fear and little faith. Likewise, in the narrative of Jonah, after he was thrown overboard, the sea became calm, and those in the ship feared God and made vows to him. So pagans realized this and turned to the true God. What about the disciples of Christ? After seeing the waves and the sea, the wind became calm, how did they react to that? Among all the men that have seen and heard from Christ, the disciples of Jesus were supposed to know more and express more trust and confidence in him. It was odd for them to not to when some of the sick and those who are low in society were able to recognize Christ. And why do I say this? Because as early as chapter 1, some of them have already witnessed the miracles of Christ through the healings he did. When Jesus healed the mother-in-law of Simon, when Jesus cleansed the leper, when he healed the paralytic and the man with the withered hand, the disciples were present when these happened. But they did not see beyond what the miracles pointed to, pointing to Jesus as Lord. They saw it merely as an astonishing and a miraculous work, nothing more. In addition, Jesus showed wisdom in how he responded to the criticisms of the Pharisees when they questioned him about fasting, observing the Sabbath, and their accusation of calling Jesus as the Prince of Demons. Jesus was able to reason and defend himself well. And lastly, he spoke in parables, showing further his wisdom. But the disciples failed to see beyond these things. In the end, they were still boggled by asking one another, "Who is this man? Who is this man that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Instead of falling down and worshiping Jesus, they find this man odd. If only they saw Jesus beyond the signs he made, it would not be an odd weather, it would not be an odd behavior of Christ, and they themselves would not have an odd response. In short, there would be nothing odd about this narrative if they saw Jesus as the Son of God, as Lord of all. They should see Jesus as Lord of all after seeing all the miracles and the wisdom that he has. After experiencing the blessings that we have in Christ, do we even dare to ask this question? After we experience all the promises of God being fulfilled in Christ, do we still dare to ask this question? Who is Christ? Who is this man? As a response to the disciples' question, my sermon title, Ask Them Back a Question. If you observe, sometimes when people ask Jesus a question, he would answer them back with a question. So here's my reply to the questions of the disciples. Don't you get who he is? Do you not get who Jesus is? If the disciples do not know who Jesus really is, then why follow him in the first place? Would you follow a stranger? I'm sure our parents has taught you and taught as they taught me not to talk to strangers or even accept anything from them. So why would the disciples and the crowds follow Jesus even if they did not fully know him? The answer is they follow him for the wrong intentions. Healings, miracles, they were marvelous and they were attracted to it. And we know that the disciples misinterpret Jesus as the king that will rescue them from Rome, and perhaps they will get a high position in the king's circle. The people also see it this way, but they fail to see him as the Son of God who will deliver them from something better, their sin and their restoration back to the Father. Ironically, the disciples were not like the pagan sailors who were with Jonah when they saw the one true God, the creator of the heavens and the earth. They made vows to him. But the disciples, they did not get who this man is after all the signs and wonders that he performed, especially after calming a huge windstorm that they themselves could not control. They did not respond by bowing down to Christ and worshiping him. Instead, they asked this odd question. Christ healed people to show his love and compassion. Christ taught in parables to show exclusivity by explaining it to his followers, but they still did not get it. So Christ had to show them that he is God by having control over nature. Later, Christ will show his power over the demons, and in the end, his victory over sin and death. All of these point to Jesus as the Son of God. So what's the story for us today? What's the relevancy of seeing this narrative? For us today, this is more than Jesus overcoming the storms of your lives. Yes, Jesus is powerful enough to save us from the storms, famines, earthquakes, COVID-19, or any way you want to define it, of our lives. However, if we only understood this message as Jesus saving us from trials and sufferings, then we are no different from the 12 disciples and the crowd. Once trials and difficulties do come our way, we may question God. God, aren't you powerful? Why am I suffering a loss in our family? Or why am I suffering a loss in my company? Or why did my friends leave me? God, you're powerful enough to help me overcome these. Jesus, where are you when I needed you the most? As the crowds and disciples followed Jesus because of miracles and blessings, nothing more, what happened in the end? What happened to the crowd that Jesus fed? Loaves and fish, that there were lots of leftovers. What happened to the 5,000 or the 10,000 or 20,000 that Jesus fed? In the end of the chapter, they left Jesus because they don't want anything about Jesus. They just want what Jesus can give them. How about the disciples? How were they when Christ was arrested in the end? They left him. They were afraid. So for us today, some of us have been Christians already for some time. But do we really get who Jesus is? How do we view Christ? Do we only see him as a source of blessing, where we can get forgiveness of our guilt? What does it mean when you call Jesus your Lord? Do we only call him when we need him, yet we still doubt him time after time? Are we different from the 12 and the crowd that followed Jesus? If we see Jesus beyond what these people saw, then praise God. Like the disciples, we too have failed at times in our trust in Christ. When he seems distant and silent, we get angry at God for leaving us. Yet, when you understand how the Bible tells about God's protection over his people and how we have security in Christ, then we will not doubt one single bit. There are times when our faith has to be tested in order for us to continue to deepen our trust in God. For once we experience success over and over again, we may forget about God and rely on our own self. In the end, Jesus never gave up on his disciples' unbelief. When you go to Acts, they boldly lived, suffered, and died for the sake of Christ. Jesus can understand you. Jesus can understand each one of us, because he too experienced what it's like to be human. and he suffered greater than any one of us will ever suffer. That's why we need Christ. That's why we need a Savior. During this quarantine period, how have you balanced your time with God? This is the best time actually for us to catch up in the past for the lost times that we were not able to spend time with God. Because once quarantine is over and we go back to our regular lives, we'll be busier than we were in the last 2.5 months. Shallow knowledge of Christ results in shallow response to shallow things. Shallow knowledge of Christ results in shallow response to shallow things. Without the peace that comes from Christ, even the petty things will break us. Lastly, this narrative shows that Jesus is the Lord of all, that we must respond in worship. We must have faith in Jesus for us to be saved, believing in Him, following Him. This narrative shows that what is greater than our faith is actually the power of an omnipotent Savior that can save us. He can save us from more than the storms of our life, because He has saved us from death and from our sins through His atoning death on the cross. That is the most powerful thing that each one of us can ever see in this world. So as Mark builds up from chapter 1 about who Jesus is, may our hope and trust in Jesus likewise build up and continue as we walk in Him and grow maturely in Him. Constantly read the Word of God. Constantly study the Word of God and hear His Word on a regular basis. It is the only way for us to truly know who He is, that we will always see Him as our Lord. We must continue to seek His face so that He will strengthen our faith in Him as well. In the end, was there anything odd about this narrative? No, if we understood who Jesus is and place our faith in Him alone. Do you now get who He is? Do you now get who Jesus is? He is the Son of God. Worship Him. Trust in Him. May God bless each one of you. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for this great reminder through the narrative of Mark that You are the Lord of all. You are the Lord of creation, for You are also the Creator of all things. And Lord, as we have seen in this narrative, may our trust in You and our faith in You continue to grow, knowing that You are the Lord of everything. You are always there watching over us, and You do not allow anything to happen without Your sovereign will. So, Heavenly Father, amidst this COVID-19 situation, we know, Lord, that You are in total control, and Your people just have to place their trust in You. So, Lord, help my fellow brothers and sisters in whatever they are facing today. May You reveal Yourself to them, that they will see Your grace and love on top of all these things. And as we continue to go throughout the next few weeks and months with uncertainties, we know, Lord, that we have a hope in You. We are certain of the hope that we have in Christ today and forevermore. Thank You once again for Your word that serves as a great reminder to us. And this we ask and pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.